What's the time, Mr. Woz?
I'll tell you. Look right here, and you can see when I turn my wrist, the hours and the minutes, nice big glowing digits. It's 11:48. It's the coolest watch in the world.
This week on Click, we're off to see the wonderful Woz. We'll sit down with Steve Wozniak, the co-founder of Apple, to talk about his predictions for the future. How easy is it to have the next big idea? We'll get down and dirty with the teams trying to create a must-have app. We'll also take to the track to test drive an app that could get you in a spin. All that plus the latest tech news, and your friends have never looked so good. Check out your connections with this week's Webscape. Welcome to Click. I'm Spencer Kelly, and welcome to Earl's Court in London, where right now the Apps World event is underway inside. This is a place for developers to show off their latest app ideas, those tiny bits of software that really do make our smartphones smart. Now, one of the special guests here today thinks that apps are truly an enormous thing. And he should know, because he is Steve Wozniak, co-founder of Apple, the company that, as it turned out, kick-started the whole app madness in the first place. Back in the 70s, Steve Jobs met Steve Wozniak, and the rest, if you like, is history. The two became firm friends, and although Steve Jobs often gets the credit for Apple's success, it was Woz, as he's known, who was the brains behind the silicon. The build-it-yourself Apple I was his baby, which didn't look much, I grant you, and so was the Apple II, the groundbreaking microcomputer which went on to sell millions. Together, the two Steves took Apple from Jobs' garage to the forefront of the personal computing revolution. Do you think times have changed then? Or do you think maybe with the return of the app on the smartphone and the tablet, we're back to the days of the bedroom programmer, any one person in effect can be a success?
There are Arduino boards and Raspberry Pi boards that young people can buy and learn about technology and even control motors and things, but there isn't as much of it. It's not as easy as it was back then, but the creative desires come out of a brain. And the creative desires are coming out in other ways. Thank God for the App Store. I am so glad for that Apple didn't say, no apps can come out except ones we write. That would have been horrible.
Do you think that was ever a possibility?
Well, from everything I read, I didn't talk to Steve Jobs directly on this one issue, that he was afraid about, he wasn't sure he wanted to have an App Store because he was more of a closed mentality.
You mentioned the Raspberry Pi. Are you a fan of getting real nuts and bolts engineering into schools as early as possible?
From a very young age on, you don't need the high level math of like calculus, you know, or the stuff you get at the university level. Any young child, even 10 years old, can actually understand enough to learn to program. And the Raspberry Pi, you can hook wires to little motors. You can actually build devices that do things. What an incredible learning experience. Or sensors, you know, that, hey, when I say a certain word, you know, it'll turn on the lights. Those are really fun projects for young people, and they are a growing step in developing the great technologists of the future that build the devices we all live with.
What do you make of the current crop of smartwatches and augmented reality glasses that we've got, the first generation, the first proper generation, if you like?
I'm actually a very big fan of it because a lot of me wants it. I don't know if the huge masses of the world want the same things, but I want a full smartphone type capability on my wrist. The trouble is, the more I think about it, I don't want the small size. There's going to be 30 companies this year that introduce small ones that are the size of the iPod Nano, which just an iPod. I want the larger size wearable. They're about to come for about 4 years. I've been talking about organic LED displays could be theoretically printed on plastic and wrapped, folded. We're just at the verge of having products that will have foldability and flexibility. I think some phone just got introduced that way in the displays, and that means it could wrap around your wrist.
And you have a display then that goes all the way around your arm.
Sure, but think out of the box. It could be on the inside of your arm, and then when you flip your arm up, it could actually flip open into your hand. and maybe it's a rubberish material. The material scientists would have to work on it and have little spring materials that maybe flatten it out, and then once it's out in your hand, it's just like holding a phone. It's just there. You flip it back, and it shuts down and grabs your wrist.
Now, we're on the verge, I think, of computers understanding human gestures and human speech, but it's not there yet, is it?
It's well on the way to starting. It's not to an end conclusion, because I can say things to you that you would understand what those words mean, and when I speak them into Siri, it doesn't understand what a human would understand that I'm asking it, you know, question. Sometimes I say, go to Joe's Diner, and it doesn't know where Joe's Diner is. And very often, usually I find out that Android does. Well, Android is based upon Google's search engine, which takes the information base, the total databases of all the world that's on the internet, and has search engines scouring them and figuring what are people looking for. Relevance of what how people use words is probably what you meant. I think that is actually the future of intelligence, probably, for computers getting more smarter and getting artificial intelligence. I wish to God that Apple and Google were partners in the future.
How likely do you think that would ever be?
Well, you know, I don't know. I wish I were there. If I were there, it'd be pretty likely. But, you know, I'm probably wrong. It's probably an awful lot I don't know about the business concerns. And one thing you got to remember is the company's always got to make money.
You're a huge fan of openness, of sharing information, sharing methods. But over the last few years, we've quite frankly been bored by all these patent wars going on, companies wanting to lock down knowledge and methods.
Some of those things are fairly simple in my mind, and almost everybody would say, hey, given the situation, I would have thought of that. Almost anyone would have. But some of them are actually very clever. It's so hard to say where should patents draw the line between obvious and having value. Should you stop other people totally from using it? I believe that you should have a world where you've got to license something at a fair price, you know, that and not an unreasonable price, and not stop them from
to recognize using. The work that's being done on it.
Yeah, because there are good things I see in Samsung phones that I wish were in my iPhone. I wish Apple would use them and could use them. And I don't know if Samsung would stop us, you know, or we think. You know, I wish everybody just did a lot of cross-licensing and sharing the good technology. All our products would be better. We'd go further. But and I do kind of wish they were more compatible.
I'd like you to turn film critic for a second here. And I would like you to just review, not the movie, but the performance of this guy when playing you.
I was very happy when I heard they hired Josh Gad, because he came from an on-stage live performance background. He did the Book of Mormon, a top Broadway play, and I have a lot of actually performing arts on stage experience in my life, in musicals, in plays, in ballets even. So I understand that the art that goes into a person like that, and how, and I knew that he would really study me well and represent me well.
And did
and
he?
He did well, except for the facts.
Next one. Joey Slotnick, Pirates of Silicon Valley. Mm-hmm. How did he do you? Did he do you justice?
I felt he did when I saw the movie. Of course, neither one of them looked like me. I was very
skinny. They have beards? What more can you ask for?
I was quite skinny when Josh Gad, in the time frame that he portrayed me, but I sure loved the joke when Steve Jobs in the movie said, Woz is carrying his own weight. Joey Slotkin actually became a friend of mine. We're Facebook friends to this day, and I admired the fact that, well, he captured, or the scriptwriter said, captured the essence of me being a good, caring person about the company and the people in Apple. Yeah.
Jorge Garcia, I, Steve. Have you seen it?
That was the greatest. That was so funny. I loved it. I love humor. Oh, my gosh. Yes.
Steve Wozniak, thank you very much for your time.
Pleasure talking with you.
Thank you.
The ever lovely Steve Wozniak, a man who was living in the future back in the 70s. Okay, more app action in a couple of minutes after a look at this week's tech news.
Software giant Adobe has confirmed a recent cyber attack compromised millions of its customer accounts. Around 38 million usernames and passwords were stolen in the attack. Just under 3 million of those accounts also had encrypted credit and debit card data compromised. The cyber attackers stole parts of the source code to popular photo editing app Photoshop 2. This could allow people to work out technical details about the program. Adobe has since reset the passwords on its site and recommends that anyone affected should change their password on any other website using the same username. Google-owned telecoms company Motorola has started development of a modular mobile phone. Users will be able to replace different parts and components of the open-source device, such as the battery, keyboard, or sensors, and create a customized handset. Motorola has teamed up with the Dutch designer Dave Harkens, who came up with a similar idea called Phone Blocks, designed to encourage users to fix or upgrade their modular phone rather than buying a new model. The world's first Bitcoin ATM has opened in a coffee house in Vancouver, Canada. After a quick palm scan security test, it allows customers to exchange their credits of the digital currency for real Canadian money and vice versa. The cyber cash is then transferred to and from the user's online Bitcoin wallets. The ATM's unveiling comes in the week a Norwegian man, Christopher Koch, found that some Bitcoins he'd bought for $22 in 2009 and forgotten about were now worth, wait for it, $850,000. Nice. A number of Dell users have complained their Latitude 6430U Ultrabooks smell of cat urine. The odor issue was first reported in June. Dell engineers say the cat urine smell isn't a health hazard. It was a problem with the manufacturing process, however, which has now changed. Users affected by the feline fragrance can send their laptop back for replacement parts. Brings new meaning to PC.
In a few minutes, we'll look at the attempts here at Apps World to come up with the next big app. But just before that, I thought you might like to see a new smartphone app, which is a game you play on your mobile device and also in the real world. And it's one that may very well take you back to your childhood. It's called Unky Drive. And Richard Taylor met up with one of the founders, Mark Palatucci, who took him through the basics.
Okay, so I'm going to choose Bosa. Each car, the objective is to shoot the other player off the track. Each car comes with different abilities. So they all have a weapon. They start with the pulse carbine weapon.
I can play this either against you or just against an AI vehicle.
Yep.
Or both, I guess.
Yep.
Right, well, let's get racing. Place mine down, give it a little push. Oh, there we go. Wow, it's got a mind of its own. So this is actually acting as a remote control as well as the brains
yes,
of the car.
Exactly.
So now, just using my thumb, I can accelerate. And rather confusingly, using the accelerometer in the actual phone itself, I can actually change direction.
Yeah, you can pretty much control your position laterally any way that you want. And there's a virtual bumper that the cars are intelligent so they don't drive off the playmat. And here's the AI car.
Now these cars look very similar to the kind of scare electric slot racing cars of the 1980s, but I'm presuming there's something a bit more advanced in them.
Yeah, so each car has a whole bunch of advanced electronics in here. There's a camera sensor, there's a microcontroller that's 100 times more powerful than the first IBM PC. There's a wireless chip so the cars can communicate with the phones.
Again, through Bluetooth, is it?
It's through Bluetooth Low Energy.
Right. And how long does the battery last in these things?
20 minutes of active play time.
Okay, that's not a huge amount of time though. I mean, so that means that if I'm having a great time and friends have come over, I've got to recharge it.
Well, it only takes about 7 minutes to recharge the cars.
Mark, that was fun, no doubt about it, but I'm just wondering whether it's got the staying power to convince people to fork out $200 for what looks on the face of it just like a simple single game.
Mm-hmm. Well, because of so much of what we do is software, and the initial thing is really just scratching the surface. So there's lots of different type of game modes that we can release, different software apps, and you make one hardware investment, but over time we can just continue to introduce new things to keep it fun and engaging.
Mark, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I talked to Steve Wozniak earlier about encouraging people to be innovators and to get into coding. And one event here at Apps World is doing just that. A two-day hackathon has just finished, filled with teams who are competing to come up with the best new idea. Prize giving is just about to take place behind me, but if you've ever wondered what these hackathons are all about, we sent LJ Rich to produce this survival guide.
Those apps bunging up your smartphone don't make themselves. Even the most basic apps still take a fair amount of coffee, coding, and creativity. Enter the hackathon, a place where there's no such thing as a bad idea. Well, nearly. I mean, those aren't even plugged in. Hackdays are well known in the technology industry. Giants like Facebook and Google have been at it for years, and for good reason. It's the source of some of their most successful ideas, such as the omnipresent Facebook Like button. And it's not just about business ideas. Recently, the charity Cancer Research UK held a hack day. This resulted in games like these that in fact help spot key faults in genes for research.
You don't have to have hardcore coding skills in order to take part in a hack day like this. You just need a bit of enthusiasm, one or two good ideas, and a team.
Of the 200 plus people here, some teams come pre-assembled, but it's completely okay to rock up on the day with the right attitude. It also helps if you have an idea.
If you have a good idea, that's all you need. You need a good idea, and we can take that, form that, and create something exciting from that.
Okay, time to get to work. When you've only got a day to make things happen, every second counts. Even if coding isn't your forte, you can still contribute. Designers and ideas people are just as essential. And if you do fancy getting stuck into coding, it's not as daunting as it might seem on first glance. A simple explanation would be translating what you want to happen into a list of instructions that a computer can understand. The apps being built here are using something called an API, or Application Programming Interface. In this case, APIs can be thought of as a specially opened gateway between someone's data and the outside world. For example, the people who run London's transport network offer up their data, such as live arrival times for buses and journey planning, in their API. This raw data is available to anyone with permission, but a load of numbers isn't exactly a recipe for success. That's where developers come in. They repackage this data into a much tastier app by combining API data with other things. For instance, mix train arrival times with your smartphone's location, and you've got an app that tells you the best way home. Today, the teams have been given access to a different set of APIs. Hackfest participants are making apps using data from other industries like cars and TV. Amid the desolation that is day two of a hackathon, those ideas have matured into working demonstrations. One team's combined TV subtitle data with Bing Translate, giving you this. It's a live multilingual subtitle translator. And Team Awesome came up with an app that combines tweets and TV schedules to generate a live play-as-you-watch quiz. Team members, who are still conscious, pitch their ideas in the hope of winning prizes. And even if Team Awesome don't win the contest, they've definitely won a place in my heart.
LJ Rich with some useful tips on how to survive that hackathon. I'm here with one of the winners, Neil Mansilla, who's just won the best app in the automotive category for your app, TAP, which stands for?
The Automotive Polygraph.
And which does?
It collects data on cars so car owners can lie about how they treated their car.
Okay, very useful. Yeah. And just in a nutshell, your tips on how to survive and do well at a hackathon.
Yeah, so come to a hackathon expecting to meet new people and learn new things and have that type of attitude and you'll do really well.
Okay, Neil, thanks for your thoughts. Congratulations.
Thank you.
The winner's ceremony continues behind me, but we're handing back to Kate Russell now with some more useful apps, hopefully. Beat those, Kate. It's Webscape.
A research paper out this week claims it's possible to tell who you are dating by looking at your Facebook connections, and somewhat chillingly, to predict when you will break up. I don't know about insights into your love life, but I have some data visualization tools for you now that might help you understand your social networks a little better. MentionMap connects to Twitter and lets you explore how users are linked to each other by the hashtags they use. What would you
do if a hashtag, in case you're wondering, is a word or phrase prefixed by the hash symbol. It turns the word into a searchable tag, so it can be found easily by others looking for information on the same subject. Despite being associated with Twitter, which has only existed since 2006, hashtags actually originated on one of the first online chat tools, IRC, or Internet Relay Chat, as a way to index channels across the entire network since 1988.
Facebook fans can try Friend Wheel, an interesting visualization that shows all the connections between your friends. You might be surprised to learn who knows who. And last, for all you LinkedIn lovers, a visualization tool that lays bare a color-coded map of your contacts to see how they are interlinked on this enormous business network. As well as being a social space, the web is great if you like to create. And SketchToys serves up a fun platform for any freehand artists to try out making something lovely in a wibbly-wobbly drawing style that's kind of hypnotic. Even if you're not creative yourself, the drawing tool actually records the act of creation. So you can just browse through other people's works of art and see how they came together. There are some truly stunning pieces featured in the gallery, and you might pick up some artistic tips as well. Painting pictures in my mind again. Change the brush size, add a little colour, alter the vibration level for the desired effect. And then post on Facebook and Twitter to share your creative vibrations with the world. Another interesting sharing app available free on Apple and Android is Chirp.io. This unique system uses a burst of sound, a bit like birdsong, to transmit an image to any phones within hearing range that are using the app. Just a burst of chirp, and it instantly appears on the other phone. As well as being a cool trick to show your friends, this sound transmission method means that you can share an image with multiple phones from any device capable of playing the sound. Even a PA system, which has interesting possibilities for marketing and events. You can use the app to share the latest updates from your camera roll with a whole group of people all at once. Just make sure they're expecting your transfer first. Music fans should set a reminder for a first this weekend. YouTube, the site that made Justin Bieber famous, is launching its own music awards. I know, don't let Justin Bieber put you off, as the event will be headlined by Lady Gaga and streamed live on the 3rd of November.
Kate Russell's Webscape. Those links, of course, are available at our website if you miss them, along with various bits of this and previous programmes and your daily dose of tech news too. bbc.co.uk/click is the address you need. And if you'd like to get in touch about anything you've seen today, you can email us, click@bbc.co.uk, or you can get hold of us on Twitter, Google+, and Facebook too. That is it from Apps World, though. Thank you very much for watching, and we will see you next time.